This bacterium here produces one of the most powerful poisons known to science. Even a tiny amount can stop your muscles from working, including the ones that keep you breathing, and you can't smell or taste it in food. Recently, deadly food poisoning cases were reported in Italy. What happened? It all started with a sandwich in the coastal town of Diamante in Italy. A 52-year-old man stopped at a food truck and he ordered a sausage and a broccoli sandwich, but hours later he was in the hospital, and by the end of the day, unfortunately, he passed away. He died. Nine others who ate the same food were also admitted to hospitals, and not long after, in Sardinia, in a different region, another outbreak was unfolding. At a festival, the Fiesta Latina, visitors lined up for tacos with guacamole, and days later, eight people were hospitalized, and one of them, a 38-year-old woman, died. Among the survivors is also an 11-year-old boy, and his case, I think, is particularly hard to bear and to talk about, because his condition was so severe that he was flown to a clinic in Rome, and as of now he is stable but still in pediatric intensive care, and the doctors are now preparing surgery for him to help him breathe more easily and to reduce the risk that he has to use a breathing machine, and a so-called a ventilator from now on. But for now there has been a little improvement. Now, what happened to all of these cases? Well, all of them were caused by botulism. This is a rare but dangerous form of food poisoning, and it happens when Clostridium botulinum, that's a bacterium found naturally in soil and water, when it produces a powerful neurotoxin in food that has not been preserved or stored properly. So even a trace amount of this poison, of this toxin, can block the signals between the nerves and the muscles, and this leads to paralysis and, without treatment, to death. Now, once the outbreaks were recognized, then of course the Italian health authorities acted very quickly. Emergency supplies of botulism antitoxin were rushed from the poison control center in Pavia to the hospitals treating the patients. Prosecutors ordered the seizure of broccoli in oil linked with the outbreak, and in Sardinia the avocado pulp, which was imported and used for the guacamole, was also recalled, and of course samples were sent for testing. So why is this toxin so dangerous? Well, once inside the body, the toxin enters the nerve endings that control the muscles and blocks the release of acetylcholine. This is a neurotransmitter. It's a chemical that signals the muscles to contract. And the muscles themselves aren't damaged, but without this neurotransmitter, they go limp and they stop responding. So in other words, the person becomes paralyzed. And if the breathing muscles are affected, then a ventilator, it's a machine, is the only way that's able to keep the person alive until the body regrows new nerve endings. And this can take weeks or even months. So antitoxins can be injected, and this can stop any toxin that is still circulating in the blood, but it cannot reverse the paralysis once it started. Now, many people have already heard of this toxin before, but not because of the food poisoning. In medicine, it's best known as Botox, and it's used in very small and carefully controlled doses to treat muscle spasms, migraines, and most famously also in cosmetics, it's to smooth out wrinkles. So it's the same substance that can cause deadly food poisoning and paralysis, but in medicine it's used in a safe and also in a very targeted way. Yeah, but in food, of course, there is nothing safe about it. So how does this toxin end up in there? Clostridium botulinum, the bacterium, survives in the environment as spores. These are tiny dormant forms that can withstand boiling water even for hours. And in low oxygen, low acid, moist environments, like for example oil packaged vegetables, vacuum sealed fish, some canned goods, these spores can germinate and it can produce the toxin. So the toxin itself is easily destroyed by high temperature. For example, boiling it for 10 minutes makes the food quite safe, but the spores are much tougher and they require heating up to 121 degrees Celsius under pressure, as done in proper pressure canning. And when the food is processed correctly, of course, botulism should not occur. And this kind of tragedy, yes, it has happened already before, more than 100 years ago, in the summer of 1919, canned ripe olives from California caused one of the deadliest botulism outbreaks in US history. At a banquet in Canton, Ohio, guests at the table were served olives that some described as smelling like Limburger cheese and sticking to the tongue. Now, 3 to 3.5 of these olives were actually enough to be fatal. Similar outbreaks in Michigan and Montana also brought the total death toll to 17 people. And the bottom line is don't eat food that smells bad. Now, and as tragic as this was, because of this event reshaped food safety in America, because public outrage and scientific investigation led to strict sterilization standards for canned olives and the creation of the Botulism Commission. And in 1925, the Cannery Inspection Act of California was also passed. Basically, applying science can make food safer, and for decades that followed, botulism from properly processed canned foods was basically nearly disappeared. So can it happen also without spoiled food? Yes, in babies under 12 months old, their intestines aren't able to prevent Clostridium botulinum bacteria from growing. So honey can carry these spores, and in an infant's digestive system, these spores can germinate and can produce the toxin, and this is called infant botulism, and it's why health agencies everywhere warn against giving honey to babies under 1 year old. So most prevention happens long before food even reaches the kitchen, so in the factory where acidity, heat, treatment and storage are very controlled. And as consumers, we can't really fix that step, but our part is also much simpler. We can store the foods exactly as the label says. We can keep oil packaged products in the fridge after opening, and we can keep vacuum packed goods ready to eat items properly chilled in the refrigerator. Yeah, and if a jar can is bulging outwards or leaking or bursts when you open it or it smells bad, well, of course you don't taste it, you just throw it away, and you just pay attention to recalls and also those expiry dates. But in doubt, bin it. And of course you also want to trust, of course, your nose, and if something smells bad, like a cheese, for example, even though it's not cheese, you probably don't want to eat it. Now, a special note also for parents, don't give honey to your babies under 1 year of age, because it can carry the spores that cause infant botulism. And in some countries, more than half of the cases of botulism every year occur in babies. So if you do home canning low acid foods, well, most people don't, but if you do that, well, then you use a pressure cooker and you follow the tested guidelines strictly. Otherwise, just basically stick to the commercially processed products. So what's the bottom line? Well, botulism is one of the most preventable forms of food poisoning, but only if every step from the production to your kitchen is actually done right. And the lessons from the 1919 outbreak still apply today. The science to prevent botulism has been known for over a century, but prevention only works if you actually also put it into practice every single time. So thanks for watching. I'm Oliver from Microbehunter, new microbiology explainers every week. You have got any questions, any comments? Well, there is a comment section below. All the best. Bye-bye. See you in the next video.